collected the hungry howling of the wolves, and he himself became hungry. So he halted at a lonely house in which a light was burning. And quoth, "Hunger attacketh me," and quoth, "Said Zarathustra," and quoth, "Like a robber. Among forests and swamps my hunger attacketh me, and late in the night, and quoth, strange humors have my hunger. Often it cometh to me only after a repast, and all day it hath failed to come, where hath it been?" And quoth, "Ay." And thereupon Zarathustra knocked at the door of the house. An old man appeared, carried a light, and asked, and quoth, "Who cometh unto me in my bad sleep?" And quoth, "Living man and a dead one." And quoth, said Zarathustra, and quoth, "Give me something to eat and drink, I forgot it during the day." "He that feedeth the hungry refresheth his own soul," said Wisdom. And quoth, the old man withdrew, but came back immediately and offered Zarathustra bread and wine. And quoth, "A bad country for the hungry." And quoth, said he, and quoth, "That is why I live here. Animal and man come unto me, the anchorite, but bid thy companion eat our seed." Zarathustra S. Prologue, CJE. And quoth, "My 17. Drink also, he is wearier than thou." And quoth, Zarathustra answered, "Companion is dead, I shall hardly be able to persuade him." And quoth, "He, tea." And quoth, "That does not concern me." And quoth, said the old man solemnly, "That knocketh at my door must take what I offer him. Eat, and fare ye well." And quoth, thereafter Zarathustra again went on for 2 hours, trusting to the path and the light of the stars, for he was an experienced night walker, and liked to look into the face of all tide flesh. When the morning dawned, however, Zarathustra found himself in a thick forest, and no path was any longer visible. Heaven put the dead man in a hollow tree at his head, for he wanted to protect him from the wolves, and laid himself down in the ground in moss. And immediately he fell asleep, tired in body, but with a tranquil soul. Long slept Zarathustra, and not only the cruelty dawn passed over his head, but also the morning. At last, however, his eyes opened, and amazedly he gazed into the forest, stillness, amazedly he gazed into himself. Then he arose quickly, like a seafarer who all at once came to land, and he shouted for joy, for he saw a new tree. And he spake thus in his heart, "A light hath dawned upon me. I need companions, living ones, not dead companions and corpses, which I carry with me where I will. But I need living companions, who will follow me because they want to follow themselves and to the place where I will. A light hath dawned upon me, not O the people of Zarathustra to speak, but O companions. Zarathustra shall not be the herd and herdsman in town. I ate Zarathustra S. Prologue." objective value, the breaker, the law breaker. He, however, is the creator. Behold the believers of all belief. Whom do they hate most? Him who breaks up their tables of value, the breaker, the law breaker. He, however, is the creator. Companion, the creator teaches, not corpses and not herds or believers either. Fellow creators, the creator teaches those who grade new values on new tables. Companions, the creator teaches, and fellow reapers, for everything is ripe for the harvest with him. But he lacketh the 100 sickles, so he plucketh the ears of corn in his beck. Companions, the creator seeketh, and such as know how to wet their sickles. Destroyers, will they be called, and despisers of good and evil. But they are the reapers and rejoicers. Fellow creators, Zarathustra seeketh, fellow reapers and fellow rejoicers, Zarathustra seeketh, what hath he to do with herds and herdsmen and corpses? And thou, my first companion, rest in peace. Well have I buried thee in thy hollow tree, well have I hid thee from the wolves. But I part from thee, the time hath arrived. Twixt rosy dawn and rosy dawn there came unto me a new truth. I am not to be a herdsman, I am not to be a grave digger. Not any more will I discourse unto the people, for the last time have I spoken unto the dead. Zarathustra S. C.H. Prologue 19. With the creators, the reapers, and the rejoicers will I sow. The rainbow will I show them, and all the stairs to the Superman. To the lone dwellers will I sing my song, and to the twain dwellers, and unto him who hath still ears for the unheard. Will I make the heart heavy with my happiness? I make for my goal, I follow my course, over the loitering and tardy will I leap. Thus let my ongoing be there down. Going. 10. This had Zarathustra said to his heart when the sun stood at noontide. Then he looked inquiringly aloft, for he heard above him the sharp call of a bird. And behold, an eagle swept through the air in wide circles, and on it hung a serpent, not like a prey, but like a friend, for it kept itself coiled round the eagle's neck. And quoth, they are mine animals, and quoth, said Zarathustra, and rejoiced in his heart. And quoth, the proudest animal under the sun, and the wisest animal under the sun, they have come out to reconnoiter. They want to know whether Zarathustra still liveth. Verily, do I still live? More dangerous have I found it among men than among animals. In dangerous paths goeth Zarathustra. Let mine animals leave me. And quoth. When Zarathustra had said this, he remembered the words of the saint in the forest. Then he sighed and spake thus to his heart. And quoth, would that I were wiser. Would that I were wise from TTM very hard, like my serpent. For an amp, GT, 0, ZARATHUSTRAS prologue. But I am asking the impossible. Therefore do I ask my pride to go always with my wisdom. And if my wisdom should someday forsake me, alas, it loveth to fly away. May my pride then fly with my folly. And quoth. Thus began Zarathustra S. down going. Thus spake Zarathustra. F1RST card. Flash dot. The three metamoid phases. three metamorphoses of the spiritual identity into you. Now the spirit becometh a camel, the camel a lion, and the lionette. Last a child. Many heavy things are there for the spirit, the strong load-bearing spirit in which reverence dwelleth, for the heavy and the heaviest longeth its strength. What is heavy? So ask of the load-bearing spirit, then he leveth down like the camel, and wants it to be well laden. What is the heaviest thing, ye heroes? Ask of the load-bearing spirit, that I may take it upon me and rejoice in my strength. Is it not this, to humiliate oneself in order to mortify one's pride? To exhibit one's folly in order to mock at one's wisdom? Or is it this, to desert our cause when it celebrateth its triumph? To ascend my mountains to tempt the tempter? Or is it this, to feed on the acorns and grass of knowledge, and for the sake of truth to suffer hunger of soul? Or is it this, to be sick and dismiss comforters, and make friends of the deaf, who never hear thy requests? Or is it this, to go into foul water when it is the water of truth, and not disclaim cold frogs and hot toads? Or is it this, to love those who despise us, and give one's hand to the phantom when it is going to frighten us? All these heaviest things the load-bearing spirit taketh upon itself, and like the camel, which, when laden, hasteneth into the wilderness, so hasteneth the spirit into its wilderness. 23. 24. Thus spake Zarathustra. But in the loneliest wilderness happeneth the second metamorphosis. Here the spirit becometh a lion, freedom will it capture, and lordship in its own wilderness. Its last lord it here seeketh. Hostile will it be to him, and to its last god. For victory will it struggle with the great dragon. What is the great dragon which the spirit is no longer inclined to call Lord and God? And quoth, thou shalt, and quoth, is the great dragon called. But the spirit of the lion saith, and quoth, I will, and quoth, thou shalt, and quoth, leap in its path, sparkling with gold a scale-covered beast, and on every scale glittereth golden, and quoth, thou shalt, and quoth. The values of a thousand years glitter on those scales, and thus speaketh the mightiest of all dragons, and quoth, all the values of things glitter on me. All values have already been created, and all created values do I represent. Verily, there shall be no I will anymore. And what, thus speaketh the dragon. My brethren, wherefore is there need of the lion and the spirit? Why suspenseth not the beast?
Thank you.
hearables nonsense for me also. No, I will what people sought formerly above all else when they sought teachers of virtue. Good sleep they sought for themselves, and poppyhead virtues to promote it. To all those belauded sages of the academic chairs, wisdom was sleep without dreams, they knew no higher significance of life. Even at present, to be sure, there are some like this creature of virtue, and not always so honorable, but their time is past. And not much longer do they stand, there they already lie. Blessed are those drowsy ones, for they shall soon nod to sleep. Thus spake Zarathustra, J. Backworldsman. Once on a time, Zarathustra also cast his fancy beyond man, like all backworldsmen. The work of a suffering and tortured god, did the world then seem to me. The dream and diction of a god, did the world then seem to me, colored vapors before the eyes of a divinely dissatisfied one. Good and evil, and joy and woe, and I am now colored. BACKWORLDSMEN 29. Vapors did they seem to me before creative eyes. The creator wished to look away from himself, thereupon he created the world. Intoxicating joy is it for the sufferer to look away from his suffering and forget himself. Intoxicating joy and self-forgetting, did the world once seem to me. This world, the eternally imperfect, an eternal contradiction S image and imperfect image and intoxicating joy to its imperfect creator, thus did the world once seem to me. Thus, once on a time, did I also cast my fancy beyond man, like all backworldsmen. Beyond man, forsooth. Ah, me brethren, that God whom I created was human work and human madness, like all the gods. A man was he, and only a poor fragment of a man and ego. Out of mine own ashes and woe came unto me, that phantom. And verily, it came not unto me from beyond. What happened, my brethren? I surpassed myself, the soothsaying one. I carried mine own ashes to the mountain, a brighter flame I contrived for myself. And lo, there upon the phantom withdrew from me. To me the convalescent who would now be suffering and torment to believe in such phantoms. Suffering would it now be to me, and humiliation. Thus speak I the backworldsman. Suffering was it, and infinitely created all backworlds, and assured madness of happiness, which only the greatest sufferer experienced. Weariness, which seeketh to get to the ultimate in one leap, with a death leap, a poor ignorant weariness, unwilling even to live any longer, that created all gods and backworlds. Believe me, my brethren, it was the body which was hairy, the body it broke with the anger of the infatuated spirit at the ultimate walls. 30. Thus spake Zarathustra. Believe me, my brethren, it was the body which was spared at the earth and heard the vowels of the system speaking unto it. And then it sought to get through the ultimate walls with its head and not with its head only into and thought, the other world, and thought, but that in thought, other world and thought, is not concealed from man, that humanized, in human world, which is a celestial knot, and the vowels of existence do not speak unto man, except as man. Verily, it is difficult to prove all being, and hard to make it. body will I speak a word that they despise is caused by their esteem. What is it they created? Esteeming and despising and worth them will. The creating self created for itself esteeming and despising. It created for itself joy and woe. The creating body created for itself spirit, as a hand to its will. Even in your folly and despising ye each serve yourself, ye despisers of the body. I tell you, your very self wanteth to die, and turneth away from life. No longer can yourself do that which it desires most. 34. Thus spake Zarathustra. Create beyond itself. That is what it desires most. That is all its fervor. But it is now too late to do so. So yourself wish yet to succumb, ye despisers of the body. To succumb so wish yet yourself, and therefore have ye become despisers of the body. For ye can no longer create beyond yourself. And therefore are ye now angry with life and with the earth. And unconscious envy is in the sidelong look of your contempt. I go not your way, ye despisers of the body. Ye are no bridges for me to the Superman. Thus spake Zarathustra. My brother, when thou hast a virtue, and it is thine own virtue, thou hast it in common with no one. To be sure, thou wouldst call it by name and caress it. Thou wouldst pull its ears and amuse thyself with it. And lo, then hast thou its name in common with the people, and hast become one of the people and the herd with thy virtue. Better for thee to say, and cloth, ineffable is it, and nameless, that which is pain and sweetness to my soul, and also the hunger of my bowels, and cloth. Let thy virtue be too high for the familiarity of name, and if thou must speak of it, be not ashamed to stammer about it. Joys and passions. 35. Thus speak and stammer, and why, that is my good, that do I love, thus did it please me entirely, thus only do one desire the good. Not as the law of a god do I desire it, not as a human law. For a human need do I desire it. It is not to be a guidepost for me to super earths and paradises, and earthly virtue is it which I love, little prudence is therein, and the least everyday wisdom. But that bird built its nest beside me. Therefore, I love and cherish it now sitteth it beside me on its golden eggs. And cloth, thus shouldst thou stammer, and praise thy virtue. Once hadst thou passions and calledst them evil, but no sc. Hast thou only thy virtues, they grew out of thy passions. Thou implanted st thy highest aim into the heart of those passions, then became they thy virtues and joys. And though thou wert of the race of the hot-tempered, or of the voluptuous, or of the fanatical, or the vindictive, all thy passions in the end became virtues, and all thy devils angels. Once hadst thou wild dogs in thy cellar, but they changed at last into birds and charming songstresses. Out of thy poisoned roots thou balsam for thyself, thy cow, affliction, milk st thou now drinketh thou the sweet milk of her udder. And nothing evil groweth in thee any longer, unless it be the evil that groweth out of the conflict of thy virtues. My brother, if thou be fortunate, then wilt thou have one virtue and no more, thus goest thou easier over the bridge. Illustrious is it to have many virtues, but a hard lot, and many a one hath gone into the wilderness necessary are the envy and the distrust and the backbiting among the virtues. Lo, how each of thy virtues is coveted of the highest place. It wanteth thy whole spirit to be its herald. It wanteth thy whole power, in wrath, hatred, and love. Jealous is every virtue of the other, and a dreadful thing is jealousy. Even virtues may succumb by jealousy. He whom the flame of jealousy encompasses, turneth at last, like the scorpion, the poison sting against himself. Ah, my brother, hast thou never seen a virtue backbite and stab itself? Man is something that has to be surpassed, and therefore shalt thou love thy virtue, for thou wilt succumb by them. Thus spake Zarathustra. 6. Hail criminal! Ye do not mean to slay, ye judges and sacrificers, until the animal hath bowed its head. Lo! The hail criminal hath bowed his head. Out of his eyes speaketh the great contempt. And quoth, mine ego is something which is to be surpassed. Mine ego is to meet the great contempt of man and quoth, so speaketh it out of that I. When he judged himself that was his supreme moment, let not the exalted one relapse again into this low state. There is no salvation for him who thus suffereth from him. Self, unless it be speedy death. The pale criminal. 37. Your slaying, ye judges, shall be pity, and not revenge, and in that ye slay, see to it that ye yourselves justify life. It is not enough that ye should reconcile with him whom ye slay. Let your sorrow be love to the Superman, and thus will ye justify your own survival. And quod, enemy and quod, shall ye save and not and quod, villain, and quod, invalid and quod, shall ye save and not and quod, wretch, and quod, fool and quod, shall ye save and not and quod, sinner, and quod. And thou, dread judge, if thou wilt say audibly all thou hast done in thought, then would everyone cry, and quod, away with the nastiness and the virulent reptile. And quod, but one thing is the thought, another thing is the deed, and another thing is the idea of the deed. The wheel of causality does not roll between them. An idea made this pale man pale. Adequate is he for his deed when he did it, but the idea of it, he could not endure. When it was done, evermore did he now see himself as the doer of one deed. Madness, I call this, the exception reversed itself to the rule in him. The streak of chalk bewitched the hen, the stroke he struck bewitched his weak reason. Madness after the deed, I call this. Hearken, ye judges, there is another madness besides, and it is before the deed. Ah, ye have not gone deep enough into this soul. Thus speaketh the red judge. And quod, why did this criminal calm MIT murder? He meant to rob. And quod, I tell you, however, that his soul wanted blood, not booty. He thirsted for the happiness of the knife. But his weak reason understood not this madness in it. Persuaded him. And quod, what matter about blood? And quod, it said, and quod, wishest thou not, at least, to make booty thereby? Or take revenge? And quod. 38. Thus spake Zarathustra. And he hearkened unto his weak reason, lightly lay its words upon him, thereupon he robbed when he murdered. He did not mean to be ashamed of his madness. And now once more is the leader revealed upon him, and once more is his weak reason so benumbed, so paralyzed, and so dull. Could he only shake his head, then would his burden roll off, but he shaketh that head. What is this man? A mass of diseases that reach out in death. The world through the spirit, where we want to get there. Pray, what is this man? A coil of wild serpents that are seldom at peace among themselves, so they go toward the heart and seek prey in the world. Look at that poor body. Yet it suffered and craved, forcibly interpreted to itself and interpreted it as murderous desire and eagerness for the happiness of the night. Him who now turneth sick, the eagle overtaketh which is. Now the eagle, he seeketh to cause pain with that which causeth him pain. But there have been other ages, and another evil and good. Once was thou evil, and the will to self. Then the angel became a heretic or sorcerer, and heretic or sorcerer he suffered. And tried to cause suffering. But this will not enter your ears. It hurteth your good people, you tell me. But what does it matter to me about your good people? Many things in your good people cause me disgust, and verily, not their evil. I would that they had a madness by which they become, like this pale criminal. Verily, I would that their madness were called true, or reading and writing, 39. Fidelity, or justice, that they have their virtue in order to live long, and in wretched self-complacency. I am a railing among tribes of torrent, whoever is able to grasp me may grasp me. Their crutch, however, I am not. Thus spake Zarathustra. 7. Reading and writing. Of all that is written, I love only what a person hath given me with blood. Write with blood, and thou wilt find with blood. His spirit. It is no easy task to understand unfamiliar blood. I hate that. Reading idols. He who knows the reader, knows nothing more for the reader. Another century of readers and spirit itself will sting. Everyone being allowed to learn to read, ruineth in the long run not only writing but also thinking. Once spirit was God, then it became man, and now it even becometh populous. He that writeth in blood and proverbs does not want to be read, but learned by heart. In the mountains the shortest way is from peak to peak, but for that root thou must have long legs. Proverbs should be geeks, and those spoken to should be big and tall. The atmosphere rare and pure, danger near and the spirit third of joyful wickedness, thus the things well matched. I want to make goblins about me, for I am courageous. Me. 4-0. Thus spake Zarathustra. Courage which scareth away ghosts. Treated for itself goblins and wanteth to laugh. I no longer feel in common with you, the very cloud which I see beneath me, the blackness and heaviness at which I laugh, that is your thunder cloud. Me were the lost when ye long for exaltation, and I look downward because I am exalted. Who among you can at the same time laugh and be exalted? He who climbeth on the highest mountains, laugheth at all tragic plays and tragic realities. Courageous, unconcerned, scornful, coercive, so wisdom wisheth us. She is a woman, and ever loveth only a warrior. Ye tell me, and quoth, life is hard to bear. And quoth, but for what purpose should ye have your pride in the morning and your resignation? peon in the evening. Life is hard to bear. Do not affect to be so delicate. Our ale of the spine sump your asses and she asses. What have we in common with the rosebud, which trembles because a drop of dew hath formed upon it? It is true we love life, not because we are wont to live, but because we are wont to love. There is always some madness in love, but there is always, also, some method in madness. And to me also, who appreciate life, the butterflies, and soap bubbles, and whatever is like them amongst us, seem most to enjoy happiness. To see these light, foolish, pretty, lively little sprites put about that moveth Zarathustra to tears and songs. I should only believe in a god that would know how to dance. And when I saw RNY Devil, Jay found him serious, thorough. THETREONTHEHILL 41. Profound, solemn, he was the spirit of gravity through him all things fall. Not by wrath, but by laughter, will we slay. Come, let us slay the spirit of gravity. I learned to walk, since then have I let myself run. I learned to fly, since then I do not need pushing in order to move from a spot. Now am I light, now do I fly, now do I see myself under myself. Now there dances a god in me. Thus spake Zarathustra, 8, the tree on the hill. Zarathustra S.I. had perceived that a certain youth avoided him. And as he walked alone one evening over the hills surrounding the town called Enquot, the tied cow, and Enquot, behold, there found he the youth sitting leaning against a tree, and gazing with weary look into the valley. Zarathustra thereupon laid hold of the tree beside which the youth sat, and spake thus, Enquot, if I wished to shake this tree with my hands, I should not be able to do so. It listeth. But the wind, which we see not, troubles and bendeth it up. Where sores bend and troubled by invisible hands, Enquot. Thereupon the youth arose was converted, and said, Enquot, I hear Zarathustra, and just now was I thinking of him. Enquot, Zarathustra, answered. Enquot, why art thou frightened on that account? But it is the same with man as with the tree. 42. Thus spake Zarathustra. The more he seeketh to rise into the height of light, the more differs he in his root struggle earthward, downward, into the dark and deepness of the evil. Enquot, yea, into the evil. Enquot, cried the youth. Enquot, how is it possible that thou hast discovered my soul? Enquot, Zarathustra smiled, and said, Enquot, many a soul one will never discover, unless one first invent it. Enquot. Enquot, yea, into the evil. Enquot, cried the youth once more. Enquot, thou sayest the truth, Zarathustra. I trust myself no longer since I thought to rise into the height, and nobody trusted me *NY longer. How does it happen? I change too quickly. My today repeateth my yesterday. I often overleap the steps when I clamber, for so doing, none of the steps pardons me. When aloft, I find myself always alone. No one speaketh unto me, the thought of solitude making me tremble. Thus do I seek on the height. My contempt and my longing increase together. on the height, and now are the lightning for the titated. Lo, what have I been since thou hast appeared amongst us? It is mine envy of thee that hath destroyed me. And quoth, thus spake the youth, and wept bitterly. Zarathustra, however, put his arm about him, and led the youth away with him. And when they had walked a while together, Zarathustra began to speak thus, it rendeth my heart. Better than thy words express it, thine eyes tell me all thy danger. As yet thou art not free, thou still seekest freedom. Too unslept hath thy seeking made thee, and too wakeful. On the open height wouldst thou be, for the stars thirst at thy soul. But thy bad impulses also thirst for freedom. Thy wild dogs want liberty, they bark for joy in their cellar when thy spirit endeavoreth to open all prison doors. Still art thou a prisoner, it seemeth to me, who devises liberty for himself. Ah! Sharp becometh the soul of such prisoners, but also deceitful and wicked. To purify himself, is still necessary for the freedman of the spirit. Much of the prism and the mold still remaineth in him, here hath his eye still to become. Yea, I know thy danger. But by my love and hope I conjure thee, cast not thy love and hope away. Noble thou feelest thyself still, and noble others also feel thee still, though they bear thee a grudge and cast evil with thee. Know this, that to everybody a noble one standeth in the way. Also to the good, a noble one standeth in the way. And even when they call him a good rogue, they want thereby to put him aside. 44. Thus spake Zarathustra. The new, would the noble man create, and a new virtue. The old, wanteth the good man, and that the old should be conserved. But it is not